actually, I think you know a fellow, Randy Hanna. Mm-hmm. Randy had told me, said your wife had gotten very ill and that she did that.
No, that's actually before my wife got ill.
Okay, well, he just told me that your wife had gotten ill and you ended up having to spend a lot of time taking care of her. I know. So.
In 2005, they come in with sex semen. In other words, that time, they'd pay me like $400 to go to Steamwell, and they'd record you and all this kind of stuff, and it'd be like 10 people there. Last one I went to in 2005 was probably in March or April, somewhere in that neighborhood, and I knew sex semen was on the way in, and they said they'd proved it and they was going to lease it in 3 months. And of course, that was a program, and they asked you what you're going to do. I said, I'm going to go home and sell out. He says, do what? I said, I'm going to go sell out. Well, it's getting good, man. It, cows bring big money, the milk's good. No time to leave on a good year, because if you bring that sex semen in a year, and they're already using it, because if they're going to lease it, so it takes a year to get that calf, 2 years to get her milking. That's 3 years I've got. Sell my milk cow, started my beef herd, sell those heifers over a period of time for your tax purposes each year and stuff. So I did that, and I still got a few Holsteins out of that original herd, because I take them over Wade Bingham and dare them and let him milk them. And but after I sold out in 2005, of course, I had beef cows and Holsteins, and then in 2007, my wife was diagnosed with breast cancer, and she went back and forth chemo, but she never gave up. She was she's only 46 at that time. She's 11 years younger than me, and we've got two kids together, and they were probably 15 and 14 when she passed away, and we homeschooled them. She had a master's degree and had taught and coached, not while we were married.
Her older sister died with cancer at 49, very similar. Lived on the farm, taught, had a master's degree, and just...
Well, my wife was young, outgoing, taught kids, smart. We was buddies, It's not like having a marriage. It's your buddies. You rely on each other. And you did things together. And since I wasn't during, I wouldn't be even a drag commissioner, put it that way. But after I got out, beef cows were, you want to watch them graze so much, So I got my license. A guy called me one day, and I got my license for insurance. And I didn't think about selling it. I just want to learn about it. I'm that kind of person. I want to learn about things. And this guy called me, wanted me to take over the insurance. I said, no. And he said, well, I'll see you at 4. And he took me around. I didn't know what a debit was, like everybody else. But I tell him a debit, so it's a what? And he took me around. These little ladies having some cookies and stuff. He'd been picking it up forever. And I said, Billy, what do you do this for? Don't they know what a stamp and envelope is? Said it's like an old doctor. Said you go by and check your beneficiaries and insure the kids, and it's this ongoing thing. And he said it guaranteed salary 6 months. And what have I got to lose? It'd be a good thing for me, with the cows and stuff. So I went to work with him. And of course, this was 2007 when she was diagnosed, and it'll give me some time to make some income for her and stuff, and give me something to do. But she never quit. I mean, she take chemo and she liable to go take kids to Pennsylvania or whatever. She never quit. I mean, 4-H leaders, we went to Houston and the events, and I mean, she never gave up till the very end. And like I said, she got where she couldn't get out of bed for the last month or two. And that was tough on the kids and stuff. So,
how old are your kids?
And they're right now 19 and 21. But see, I put them in college. She won't know what I was going to do. I said, well, I'm going to put them in college. And she said, what? And I said, well, I'm just past interest. I would do that and send them to high school. They're going to be around intelligent people, professors, and they're going to get their degrees. So they took them. They passed and went there, and they had to take so many courses to graduate. And the young one, the oldest one, had 25. So she went to Waco and got a sign language degree, because they'd done that when they were. Now she's at Commerce at... A&M
Commerce, used to be East Texas. Texas
Teachers College. This summer she's at home, but she's taking course out Hill summer school, chemistry and stuff. The little one had an associate's degree at 18 when she graduated high school. She had a 4-point grade average, so she didn't want to work at McDonald's, so she could get a teacher's aide. So she went to work as a teacher's aide, so you get paid year round. Last year she went to Ireland and France and England, and she's a very ambitious kid. I mean, just low key. And this year she's going to Hollywood because she wants to do the makeup for the stars, because she took some of those as electives in college. And And she's going to teach us next year. And the next summer, while she's getting taught, she's going to move to California and kind of do some of that as apprenticeship and courses you take out there. So that's my kids. And, you know, at this age, daddy's got to be close as that cell phone. You're not vacating them, but daddy needs to be doing something away from the farm.
Okay, now you brought up a serious question. Because I'm a little older than you, but yet that what you're doing describes the way I see it. That's an enjoyable life. If by some chance we wake up first Tuesday in November and you have won this thing, you realize that's going to change.
Well, I'm saying that's what it's all about.
And now you're not going to be able to be as relaxed and laid back as you are now. You're going to be in charge of a
690 employees, $592 million, 14 offices. All right. I'm saying that.
What are you going to do that next morning? Well, you got a month. I got a month and a half
to retire from this job
before you take over down there.
Right. I'm going to go to the office. I'm going to go right down there. I'm going to talk to Mr. Staples and a lot of people. I'm going to talk to Nolan Ryan, a lot of people. I'm going to talk to Susan Combs. Might get a hold of Randy White. That's on the big end. Yeah. But I'm going to do small farmers and stuff. Main job is to talk to Drew Deberry and Shannon Roos. And they make more than the Ag Commission. You knew that, I guess. While Todd was away running, they run the place.
But there's a lot of things besides agriculture involved in the Texas Agriculture
I know,
Commission.
Just gas pumps and school lunches and pesticides. But you don't do all that by yourself. You got 690 employees. What you got to do is make sure they're doing a good job.
Well, you pick the people that are in charge of each of those departments.
Right. You need to go to colleges and get the best people in those fields. They may not be in college. They may be people who've been in another field. And they've got, if you look online, they put those jobs online and how much the costs are. But like I said, if you're running a business, you're the head honcho. But if you don't have some people down there looking over stuff when you're not there, you're going to go broke. You got to have good employees doing that work. And that's why I say it's not a political job.
No.
It's a management job. It's a service job. Like if you run a dairy farm, you don't have good people out there that's taking care of cows and milking cows and doing a good job and keeping things clean when you're not there, well, then you're not going to do a good job. In other words, the dairy business really gave me the expertise to run for the office. And it was created in 1907 because cotton farmers wanted, you know, people and expertise
but
in there.
There's a lot of changes in the state since 1907.
I understand it. I mean, the gas pump was added.
I grew up on a farm, and I married a farmer's daughter, but I even owned a farm until about 10 years ago, but I haven't farmed for 50 years.
Right.
And even since I was on the farm, when I grew up, between our farm and Gorman, there must, I don't know how many farms there were, but there were enough, most of them were already older then, but there were enough kids living on the farm that we filled up several school buses hauling people into
right,
town.
Right.
I think there may be two people living in that stretch, that 15 miles now.
Yeah. A lot of it's probably been developed. Doctors have bought it.
No. That's just, it's corporate farming. That's what it is mainly.
Okay. They got $200,000 tractors.
They got $200,000 tractors.
Right.
They got,
and they drive them everywhere, and you know. But you also, when you got to have it out. If you're farming that big and you got one person to sell to, you're in trouble. You got to have a diversity of people to sell to. And what happened, your Walmarts and people just folded this down to control prices. And if you're young, you can see it. If you already own that $200,000 tractor, it's hard to give it up. But if you're a young farmer, so there's no way. That's crazy, you know. So there's a lot of things you've got to work on. And you can't succeed in all of it, but you've got to be working on it. And most people that's running for that office, whether it be Kiki or Asa or Mr. Davis or a lot of them. Now, Mr. Corns, I think, might have been different. But they wanted to step up to a higher office, get more retirement, whatever. That's what they're using the job for. You know, most people don't care or whatever. But I do. I'm on one term.
Well, what we've had with Staples, we've had an awful lot of talking about illegal immigrants.
Mm-hmm.
He's brought people in from all over the country and go down and walked on the border.
Mm-hmm.
He's been making a lot of noise lately about the Bureau of Land Management.
Yeah.
Talk to me about those things.
Okay. I'm not running to control the border. I don't think I have anything to do with that. If it would, I'd try to get on the immigration deal and get me a gun. But I'm not in charge of that, you know. So I need to stick to my agricultural deal. If I got a farmer down there that's having problems with immigration or something, now I need to go down and talk to him and then call the immigration and say, this man's got a problem. Can I get some people out here to help him? That's about as close as I look to it.
Do you think it's the farmers that are fussing about the immigration? Because most of them I know are using
illegal immigrants.
Using workers, whether it's guest workers or whatever.
And if the broccoli don't get picked for Mr. Corns, or if the tomatoes don't get picked, and then HEB doesn't like that, and the people's paying more for tomatoes and rotten, nobody wins. But I don't care if it's Hispanic picks them, or you and your wife go down and pick them, if that's what you want to do.
I've done that.
You see what I mean?
I'm not interested in doing it anymore.
But there is people that will pick them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I don't really care about that. That's between the man who's hiring them and working them. But then you got labor boards that, you know, look over labor and stuff. That's like, you know, I'm not God. God will have to do that on his own. I'm not in charge of that. You see what I mean? I got to set my sights on the people who are working here and the services they're responsible for.
How do you feel about a guest labor program or a guest worker program?
I don't know how many people are coming across that border. You know, that's what they want you to make decisions on statistics you don't have.
And
that's.
You
don't know how many
we had that. You know, we did have a guest worker. Well, they call it. Well, that's not what they call it. Bracero program.
Long ago, and it was long gone.
Here's the problem, right here. The reason why they crossed the border is because they want a better type of living.
Absolutely.
Now you get to the root of the problem. That's the root of the problem. Now, what started this was years ago. We had a good income and we kind of impoverished them, basically. We wanted it cheap. We'd go down and buy stuff, bring it back. Okay? When they started coming across the border, taking these low-priced jobs, at first we used to have people that would do that. But then it got better. But then when we had recessions, they're taking our jobs, they're filling up our schools, and they're doing this and this. You really can't blame them for having that attitude if they live in the city and they're making minimum wage. You know, I understand, but that's a lot different from that farmer down there trying to get people to work or that dairy herd. You got two people with totally opposite views. You see what I mean? And that's legislative, that's not farmer. Yes, if I go down there and see somebody having a heart, I'm going to go down to the legislature, go in there in session, and I said, for this farmer, here's what we've got. I'm not a lobbyist, I'm just going to tell you here, are you concerned or are you not? Of course, if it's against their party, Republican or Democrat, they ain't going to do it. You see what I mean? That's politics.
That shouldn't be, but that's politics. Lately, one time this state, the legislators in this state tended to work across, and I think they probably still do more than they do nationally.
I don't think so.
Well,
there's hardly any Democrats.
And that may be it, because there's no need to.
75-80% Republican, ain't no need to.
When Bob Bullock was down there as a Democrat, he tended to get everybody involved. Force.
One man can do a lot.
Whoever's lieutenant governor can do a lot.
Yeah.
Talk to me about BLM. You know, Staples been doing a lot of, the whole Republican Party's been doing a lot of grouching about BLM and saying they're seizing Texas land.
The way I read it is that land was back in 1800 or 1900, whatever, was government land. At some point, it got apparently got legal.
I believe it depends on the route of the river. It's that one in these river mountain border changes.
Well, this is a law thing. Right. This is not a political thing. If you've got 2,000 acres and you've got a deed to that 2,000 acres and you paid $2,000 an acre for that, then that is your land. You've got a deed to it. Don't you agree?
Depends on what the deed says.
Yeah, that's what I said. If you've got a deed to it.
Depends on what the deed says. But now, I don't remember you didn't come here to interview me, but there's been a lot more land taken by public domain seizures for the use of private companies in Texas than ever touched by the BLM. Is there any comment on any of that?
Well, it's about law. I mean, if I bought 200 acres, like in New Mexico, bought 200 acres and I got 100 acres of government land, I know that's 100 acres of government land. I don't own it. And they can do what, it's government land. They can do what they want with it.
You guys still doing all right?
Yeah.
Handy refills?
I think you
have. The same with BLM. If they knew that was government land and they didn't pay for it, that's government land. There's no question about it. Case closed. Pretty simple, isn't it? But the government and the people make it a lot complicated by putting politics into it. If this comes for you as a judge, it's your decision. We may not like it. The people who lose this won't like it. But is there any other question about it?
Well, and actually in most of those, it's not quite as simple, because normally what you've got in any, and it's, is that you've got conflicting claims. And you, if you've been farming in Texas, you know there's all sorts of things that happen with land boundaries and land claims over the years. And there's a lot of times when two people may both feel like they have a very legitimate claim to the same piece of property. Matter of fact, there have been very good neighbors, deceased being very good neighbors over that.
Well, it used to, they had insurance. You bought land insurance when you bought something. So if you come in question, insurance company had to pay for it, because that's why you
lived it back.
Yeah, that's what you closed it for. I mean, that's why we have laws.
All right, let's go back. That's why I don't know that the ag commissioner, I mean, once again, we're talking about legislative action. But at some point, if you become commissioner of agriculture, you're going to be asked about eminent domain seizures for things like pipelines, things like toll roads. There's been a lot of Texas. No, we're talking about those. Stadiums don't usually land up on farmland. Pipelines and roads do. And there's a lot of Texas farmers right now doing a lot of loud complaining about it.
The way eminent domain used to read,
for public
government
use.
Cannot seize your land unless it was for the good of all public. And some of these things come into question whether it is good for the public.
Well, and at one time it could not be, there's been some court cases on that, but at one time it could not be seized and then handed to another private property. Another private ownership.
Yeah, I don't believe in that.
Well, and that's happening now.
Yeah. Well, like I said, we're going to have to get the legislature to change that. What can I do about it other than talk out? I can talk out about it.
If you become the ag commissioner, you're going to have a bit bully pulpit.
I understand that, and that's what I said. That's, you can talk out about it, but you don't have any legislative authority.
Now,
you've got five lawyers in that place that's making a lot of money. Apparently they into a lot of that stuff, you know what I mean? And you want to confer with those lawyers about all this stuff. What's going down here and what can we do? You see what I mean? That's where the business aspect comes in, of talking to them. You know, I think Todd Staples, he's that kind of person. I think he probably talked to them. But a lot of these other people, if Kinky had got in there, Kinky wouldn't have done anything with it. You see what I mean? I mean, I don't know. I know Sid, my opponent. That's what it boils down to, me and Sid. And Sid's been in the legislature, and he's well bought. And I'm not. This is not slinging mud.
No.
He's been there six terms. He's been a lobbyist. You know what I mean? He's made a lot of buddies. Cruz is with him. The governor's with him. They're not taking me lightly. Here I'm sitting in a cafe, and they're spending money. You see what I mean? Knocking themselves out. But see what I mean? Who will do the best job? Will he go in there and talk to Gru DeBerry and go around to the offices, or, you know, he's going to get his buddies and say, we need a $750,000 grant for this guy, we need to approve a loan for this guy. That's what Perry did when he was in there. Susan Combs was pretty good. I thought she was an honest, well-working, good person. I really do. My hat's off to her. Perry, no. And Todd, I think Todd has kind of followed the good flow. If the water's running here, I'm going to go on this boat. If it's dry over there, I'm not going to go over there. If the immigration's the way to go, I'm going to go immigration. If it's eminent domain, I'm going to go eminent domain. I'm not going to block any rivers. I'm different. If I see something I don't like, you know what I mean? Yes, I got an Irish temper. You got to use it prudently, but You see what I mean?
I've got an Irish background, so I have no problem with that.
But you got to keep it cool. And the main thing is, I call it getting your arms right. You need to know what they're doing in Lubbock, Texas. You need to, are they renting these buildings? You know, that's the small deal. But you got to go all the way to the small to get the big. Okay, the money's being
spent.
One
of the other hot topics right now that you would not be directly involved with, but you would be asked about me indirectly, is, well, first off, you are directly involved. One of your jobs would be increasing, diversifying income in the rural communities, which includes small towns across Texas.
Mm-hmm.
One of the financial money providers, money cows, in a lot of these small towns are fertilizer companies.
Mm-hmm. Explosions, yeah.
Well, you know, explosions and fires. You know, we had the explosion in the West, and we had the fire in Mahia,
mm-hmm.
and there's, that's starting to be looked at.
Pretty good.
Pretty good.
Mm-hmm. Well, if they hadn't built a school next to it, after 50 years, you wouldn't have got the zoning. And somebody ought to throw the red flag up years ago, but apparently somebody went over somebody's toes. I don't care what this guy does if it blows up. You see what I mean? That's the kind of stuff. But do you close a fertilizer plant down because everybody went around it? Well, you may go talk to the fertilizer people, and Dale says, look, this is dangerous for these kids. Y'all did something bad by building all these schools and stuff around it, but if this thing blows up, I mean, it's going to kill a lot of people. We need to come to a conclusion. I'd like y'all to make it among yourself than to be told to do it.
And evidently, there's been no, there are regulations on handling that material, and there doesn't seem like anybody's ever actually enforced them or pay close attention to them.
If you're a farmer and you got that tractor, you see that big ammonia tank going down the road, that got loose, it killed people for you see what I mean?
We have way too much hazardous materials on the road. That's true.
Well, that stuff at Walmart would blow up if you had it. I mean, you go down that deal and smell it. Have you ever been down with pesticides? You probably get cancer if you walk down it enough. You see what I mean?
That's another thing ag commissioners are supposed to regulate.
I know. They do. You see what I'm talking about? Okay, if you're the one that's in charge of doing Walmarts and you're working for me, I said, what are we doing about this? What's, you know, and I said, talk to the lawyers and Drew. What have y'all, what's been y'all program here? Well, we can't do that to Walmart. I said, well, why not? Is Walmart got a super deal? We need to go down and talk to them and see what we got, you know, going. Of course, they may not like it, but we're just going to keep fighting. Because people just don't fight Walmart or Monsanto or, and they, you know, I've been asked about GMOs. Well, people that don't like in the city don't like GMOs. I said, but if you're a farmer, if you don't have an alternative, what do? Now, there's a lot of people who've got alternatives to it. Will it make money? So you do test plots and stuff. If they've got alternates, if you can make more money planting this than a GMO, you will. You got to have alternatives. You see what I mean?
Okay.
You go to colleges.
I'm glad you brought up GMOs.
Yeah.
Right now, Monsanto has been very aggressive about suing farmers.
About the seed, I'm far ahead of you.
Who not only, I'm not talking about using their own seed, who have accidentally been pollinated.
I know.
Now, if I'm sitting here raising property and something blows in on the wind,
mm-hmm.
talk to me about that.
Well, Jim, they say they own that seed. It's kind of like you got a registered bulldog here and he jumps over and gets this other lady's dog pregnant. Those are, they're not her puppies, it's yours, or cow, or anything else. No, that's not right. But the Supreme Court said it was because of money and politics. If you follow the money and the politics, you'll soon find the problems. If you get a man in there only wants one term, well, and look, he can't solve everything because he's got a host of people against him right off the bat. I mean, it's like a brick wall moving in on you. But he's got to stand up to certain things, but he's got to have prudence, smartness. You know, if you try to run through that brick wall, sometimes you may have to go around it or have a guy with a jackhammer. You see what I mean? That's country boy logic. It doesn't mean much if you don't understand the logic. That's the way I am. That's why I don't want four terms. Nobody, they've never had anybody like me. Not because I'm perfect, but coming off a farmer that's not in politics, have different kind of views, thanks to the organization ought to be a service, know his soul. No, I mean, there's people across states a lot better than me. You know what I mean? But they won't run.
No.
You might be better than me, but you're not going to run.
No, I'm not interested in that.
Yeah.
Now, and the reason I'm not interested in it, I've already made my mind up that if you're my next door neighbor, you and I'd get along real well. I think we talk the same language.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when I go back to Dallas and sit down, and what they're going to ask me is, why should we hire this guy to do this job? I mean, that's basically what you've done. When you file for a job, you're asking the people of Texas to hire you to do that
mm-hmm.
job.
Mm-hmm.
I hear what you're saying about farming. I understand. I hear what you're saying about. But right now, you're telling me that I am ready right this minute to come in and take over this basically billion-dollar corporation.
It's
for that granny lady that didn't live on the farm, or that kid that's coming out of college.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me why I tell them Jim Hogan is ready to handle that billion-dollar corporation and step in day one without it falling apart around him.
Because he's going to listen to you. If you're in college, he's going to go over and talk to you.
But how are you going to know which college person to talk to? Because you find people in college tell you opposite sides of every question you're going to bring up.
I understand. But you do that in your own business.
You can talk to my kids and get different.
I understand that. There's nobody going to give you the same answer.
Mm-hmm.
You got to have enough common sense to make the right decisions. Listen to logic. In other words, I'm listening to y'all as you speak. You know, some things we agree on, some we won't. And you'll come away with some things. Yeah, he was right on that, but I didn't get this issue. And there's nothing you can do about that. That's just life, you know. But the basic thing is, I've been a farmer. I've managed big money in dairy business and put them together. And, you know, I've been successful all my life. I've raised a family. I don't know if you call that conservative. I hate to use the word conservative and liberal. They stink anymore. They don't mean anything. Everybody wants to use the word. All I say, I've raised a family. I've been successful. I'm not in it for the money. I've talked to hookers of people in important positions, you know what I mean? Power does not scare me. But yet, I pick up a debit where people are struggling on minimum wage. You see what I mean?
Why do y'all eat this fried green beans before I put it in my mouth?
So, you know, I know agriculture, and the main thing for this job has no other qualification than to be a farmer. There's no other qualification. Can you believe that? It used to be you had to be a farmer for the last 5 years. Now it's 5 of the last 10, they watered it down. And yes, I paid my own money and I didn't loan it, it's gone. I run a race that I didn't take any money and I beat the system twice. Now beating the Republican, oh my gosh, it's like reaching the moon. It's about Republican and Democrat. I'm still out to the farm doing the things I'm doing.
I suspect, in all honesty, if you wake up second Wednesday in November and you've been elected, you're going to be shocked as hell. But I'm not saying that you won't be, but I suspect it'll be a major shock to you.
Well, I put it this way, it's a surprise. It's like the last two. How did you do it?
Did you say that to yourself at any time?
No.
Okay.
No, but when you sign up, you can run.
Absolutely.
What's your odds?
Absolutely. I have run for office before. I lost.
But this is state. This is big time. Fifth highest office in the state. This is, you know, at 63, you'd think you'd run for dog catcher first time out of the box. I run for the fifth highest office in the state.
Well, you probably have a better shot there. People around dog catchers going to make me want to know what kind of poop experience you got.
Yeah. But, you know, the people around me are giddy. I mean, you get... You're humbled. People stop you on the street and say,
Oh,
I'm so proud for you. I mean, this is great.
Yeah.
No money, you know?
I'll be stunned if you don't carry Cleveland precincts by a landslide. But,
no, this is Republican area.
I don't care.
Republicans are going to vote for me.
Yeah, but you local. I mean, I is that somebody's phone?
That's the lady's crap. Okay. Hello? Yeah. Well, do you want to come to the Blue Star Grill in a minute, get you something to eat, and we'll talk a little bit? Yeah, I'm talking to Mr. and Mrs. Hart here now, so you can come by. Bye. This lady's from Dallas, too.
Oh.
So she's been around Cleveland, the library and a burger bar and a deal to find out what kind of person I am. No, she's smart. But go ahead and we get...
I don't even remember what we were talking about. We were talking about putting you in the position here. And I understand. I'll be honest, that's still the questions I have. I mean, I hear what you're saying. You're saying, I will hire the expertise for the things that I need done. But it still comes down to who do you choose to put in that position? Who are the people? Because that's who, you're right. Anytime you're in management, it's, I don't care if you're running GM, if you're running my company, you're running your company, mm-hmm. whatever. Unless it's my company right now is a one-man company, so it's easy. I know mm-hmm. I get up and look in the morning at the worker and the manager. Right. But I have run larger companies.
You've got people advisors in that. You've got a lot of advice.
It is your decision. It's the decisions you make about the people you put in place. And
but you've got in that office, these are expertise. They've been there a long time.
You want me to take those all the way for you, ma'am?
Yes.
So y'all can visit? Thank you. Sure you ain't thirsty yet?
No. If somebody else coming too. Well,
all right.
You need to cut him a commission. He's generating a lot of business for Blue Star Grill.
I know. He comes up and sees us pretty often. We enjoy his company, that's for sure.
He has told it across the state of Texas. If you want to come to talk to Jim Hogan, you come to Blue Star Grill in Cleveland. So y'all may become put a historical marker out front.
Okay. There we go, we're working it together.
Sweet kid. Her mother buys insurance.
Yeah, that's what you said.
But it's, you know, you talk about hiring people. They've got a website where you sign up. They got jobs on there and you apply. It, you know, used to you put an ad in the paper.
Well, that's downstream. I'm talking about the four or five. You've got about, six or seven different divisions. Mm-hmm. And each of those
pesticides regulations, all that stuff.
It has got a head over it. And those are the people that you are directly, and that's the people that are going to be carrying out your policies and your beliefs.
Right.
Who do you put there? And how do you choose who you put there?
Well, first off, you start talking to the people there. You just don't say, well, I'm going to take all these people in with me and fire all these. Walk in the office, you talk to Grew and Shannon, the line of power. And it's okay, and I've got a list of these others that make over $80,000. Kirchville, I know, David Kirchville. And, you know, they give me a lot of background. But how, you know, I've got a list of people retiring. Who have y'all been hiring? What have y'all been doing to get new recruits? That's what you call advice. And, you know, I'm in here because I'm just the first one in here. It's going to take me a little while to get on my feet, but I want to know the best knowledge. And I want to see what y'all been doing in the past under different people. How you been spending the money. So you see what I mean?
January, when things take over, mm-hmm. you've got every one of these divisions. Every one of these divisions has got somebody at the head of it.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm hearing you say right now is that those people are going to stay in place until you...
If they want to be there. I mean, I'm not going to go in there and fire them. If you bought a business, would you go in there and start firing people before you knew what they did?
Well, I wouldn't bought the business before I found out what they did, personally, but mm-hmm. that would be...
Well, I've been studying, but how many people have been in the deal? Has Sid Miller been in there? He was head of cheering, alleged to give him money. He talked to, you know, the ones that come down there. You got auditors and stuff like that. Two ladies write the checks. I've been to the office. I just hadn't got through the door because they said, well, we can't see you today. You know, I got a phone here. You can call Fort Worth. Busy. You know, I want to know why. When I was down there for over an hour, nobody come in the office. But she had a book where they'd come in there and they'd seen we're corn people. And Austin's not an agriculture area. Are they renting that building? They got one on the ninth floor, one on the 11th. See, these questions in mind, just like you got. That's how you run a business. You get those questions answered as fast as you can to get your feet on the ground. But you just don't run into business and fire everybody. Because I don't think you can make everything and sell it by yourself. You got to delegate authority. In other words, what I'm saying, you have to have a little faith in the guy that's running. You want to know that he's capable. But, you know, you can't tell me in 30 minutes how you're going to run that business. You know what I mean? So, I mean, I've got the background for it, as good as Sid's got. You know, Sid's been in the legislature, but the legislature didn't run anything. He saw lobbyists and people who wanted to get bills passed. He made a lot of contacts. And as a lobbyist, he made $495,000 last 2 years. He's taking a pay cut. Why? I don't know. You see, those things are red herrings. Do you, what, basically what you got, Sid Miller and Jim Hogan. It's basically, who do you trust to go in there and work and do the right thing? Or do you think I'm going to go in there and get those $750,000 loans to my buddies? And you see what I mean? That was lobbyists. Well, I haven't been a lobbyist. I don't have those connections. I sense I don't, didn't take any money. You see where I'm coming? That's why I won't approach it. The first thing I want to know, and most people don't ask, you have, because you're a businessman. Are you capable of running that office?
Absolutely. That's the first,
that's the number one thing. Are you capable of running? Well, first thing, you got to find out what's happening.
I don't think most people, most people dealing with it don't realize what you're talking about when you're talking about a political office, and we're not.
We're talking about a business.
We're talking about a very large business.
Yes, a very $592 million. So most of it is giveaway.
Well,
the gas pumps is service. Same girl and boy goes by every year and checks that gas pump, puts a label, goes by a scale. They can do it in the sleep of night. But you need to sink low enough to say, on the 10th of the deal, I'm going to ride with this lady in Marfa, Texas to check the gas pumps. Just hop in, and you don't want to scare her. You just go check the gas pump, see if people's going. You keep an eye on these people. If you've got a person in pesticides, go with them, see what's happening.
Staples has been doing a lot of talk lately, or a lot of publicity about making it easier to get certified for pesticides.
To spray pesticides.
Right. I've seen all this publicity about it. I don't know if that's a good thing or not. I'll be honest, my first thought was, are we losing control by making it easier? But
you know, in a perfect world, we wouldn't need pesticides.
Oh, sure. Perfect world, we,
you know, but you wouldn't have to.
I haven't lived in one yet. If you have, let me know where it is.
Yeah. I'm not talking, you wouldn't use pesticides. But if you're a farmer and your corn goes to wilt and the grasshoppers on top of it, you're going to spray it because you got a crop out in the field. You see what I mean?
I do see what you mean. Now, I told you, I married a farmer's daughter who died of cancer, and in his area in West Texas, where they not only use pesticides, they use herbicides,
mm-hmm.
the cancer incidence is about 8 or 9 times what it is anywhere else
in
the state.
They kill you. Like I said, let me put a little bit in your poker.
I'm not interested.
You see what I mean?
But you, where's the line?
That's alternatives. If you don't have an alternative, like water or Coke, if you don't have an alternative, you don't have it. Just do GMOs. They're working on organisms in the soil to kill the bugs, which would be a lot smarter than using pesticides. Alternatives. Surely in college, or people like Neil Sperry, who got the natural way, has got a way.
Hello.
Come sit down. You can listen to the talk.
Yeah, I can listen to the talk.
I'll be.
No, we're fine.
Y'all can introduce yourself.
Hey, Mark.
I'm Willa Culhaby.
Please,
I'm Connor Hart.
We're having a talk about the GMOs and the pesticides right now.
Oh, yeah.
You have your name? Would you like to start out with your name, maybe?
Yeah, just, you have a lemonade?
No, I'm sorry.
We have
sweet tea, unsweet tea, we have root beer, spray.
How about unsweet tea?
Unsweet?
With lemon? Do you have lemon?
Yeah. Thank you. He knows how to look after people.
But you know, you alternatives. And it's got to be available and affordable, and farmers will use it.
Okay. Now, one thing you were talking about, Hugh, earlier. One of the things Hugh was advertising, pushing for, was the increasing organic farming. We haven't mentioned Hugh Fitzsimmons.
Oh. Okay.
The one that dropped out the first round. Talk to me about organics.
I met him at the farmer's market.
Talk to him about organics in Texas.
Great. I don't know that there's such a thing as organic, because if you spray next door and it grifts on your crop, I don't think it's organic anymore.
No, it's not.
And if it rains and it's got pesticides in it or something, or you use water that's got pesticides in it.
Well, see, now that's what I'm going to come back to you as my agriculture commissioner and say, Jim, how come you're not stopping these people from spraying on my property over here?
I got an unsweetened lemon.
And you can say, I knew when I walked into that restaurant in Cleveland and I didn't want him to talk to this guy. He's giving me a hard time.
No, I don't mind at all.
Okay,
I mean, okay. There's laws against pesticides.
If everybody's
else,
okay.
Again, I'm not legislative, but again, you say I got the bloody puppet.
That's true. You keep saying you're not legislative, but as the commissioner,
I can
tell you. You're going to have a lot more influence on legislators than I am as an individual.
I understand that. I got the bloody puppet. But those. lobbyist down there has more power than me. They got money for the... See, well, that's where I'm coming from. They got money. And I can talk all day. And, you know, they said, you're a Democrat, by the way, and I don't like you. Well, I mean, that's politics.
Oh, you know, I did tell you that we were going to elect 75% Democratic legislature this time, didn't I?
Yeah, good luck.
I didn't tell you that. I'm not going to lie to you this early in the day, Jim.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I'm just, you know.
Are you one of the five Democrats in Cleburne I've heard about?
I'm not in Cleburne.
No, we're from Arlington.
Oh.
Actually, but, and that, I do have seen the roads. There are quite a few more Democrats down here than that.
But if I was on the Republican ticket and Mr. Miller was on the Democratic ticket, you ought to be saying, hello, Mr. Commissioner. Now, what difference did it make? Am I changed any?
I'd be asking the same questions.
Yeah, and that's what it's supposed to be. I mean, I'm not. That's like what they are. You
because you still.
Democrat?
It's not a matter of how likely you are to get elected. Like I said, to me, it comes down to what you've done is file a job application, and I'm here representing the people that's deciding whether to hire you or not. So we're talking about your job application.
And I agree with you first. That's the first thing I want to know. Is he capable of doing it? What's his ideas? Well, my ideas of changing things is to work at it. If I tell you I'm going to get rid of pesticides, how big a liar do you think I am?
I hadn't asked you to get rid of pesticides.
No, but if I did, like a lot of people, I'm going to do this. That's the way they talk. I'm going to get this done. I'm going to lower your taxes.
If I thought the agriculture commissioner had an opportunity to work on GMOs, there are some things on GMOs that I'm concerned about. Monsanto's.
Yeah, I am too.
But I don't think you're going to have any control over it, so I'm not.
Well, I'm going to talk to Monsanto. You can believe me. You know, and they probably got more power than me, but I mean, I'm going to talk to them.
Are you a farmer?
I grew up on a farm.
Are you a farmer?
No, I grew
he
up
has
with
farming
only with farm people, though.
He has farming in his heritage.
I thought you were saying I had dirt in my
own. But I grew up on
a
farm.
Well, I'm
with an outfit called What Happens in Texas.
Thank you. Yeah, my ex-husband has a cousin in Iowa who's desperate to get, for his own health, to get out of the middle of Iowa because...
I'm not running for agriculture.
Right. Because what?
Because of the... overflow from the spray, and he had a dog that picked up a kernel of GMO corn, and they barely saved his life by rushing him to the veterinarian and neighbor with the dead pond because of the overflow.
Right.
So there is a lot of. So I thought maybe you did have a handle too on how to approach it. I'm just asking. I'm sorry.
Cancer is a carcinogen. That's what
it's caused by carcinogen.
Yeah. It changes the cells. And that's pesticides or anything you breathe in the air. And everything you eat, drink, and breathe today causes cancer. It's got carcinogens in it. There's probably something in that drink there, you know, in cups, you know, everything. That's why when I was a kid, I didn't see much cancer. And I would love not to have pesticides. But you go tell a farmer down in the valley, says, well, we're going to take your pesticides. You might not get off the place alive. You see what I mean? Whether it's right or wrong.
Well, I don't know that anybody's asking to do away with them. And I don't think it's the Agriculture Commission you'd be asked to do away with them. You are asked to regulate them. And
yes.
That's the point.
Yes.
Okay, let's go back to this wonderful world. We wake up. Day after the second Tuesday in November, I've actually sat up all night watching election returns, and my gosh, there's Jim Hogan with five more votes, and he is our new agriculture commissioner. Come swearing in day in January, a week afterward. What's the difference between now and then? What are you going to be doing different than Todd Staples is doing
right now?
I'm
not going to be an insurance man.
No, I mean, no, I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about the state of Texas. What's the difference between having Todd Staples down there and having Jim Hogan down there? What is there going to be a vector change? Am I going to see a change in approach, change in results?
Well, I don't exactly know what Todd Staples is doing today, do you? Most of what I've seen, he gives speeches. They do have a person down there that schedules him out.
I think
out.
He's running against Barack Obama for agriculture commissioner, best I can tell.
I think so. You again, it's all politics. But when I go down there, I'm going to see a ledger of what he's been doing. And I'm going to see, again, relying heavy on Drew and Shannon. I says, what y'all do? Are y'all going to stay on this job? Or do we need to be looking at somebody else? And I want to be a good ag commissioner, so that depends on what y'all been doing. And what the country, here's some of my ideas. You know, people's getting old. Who is responsible in this chain of people? I want to talk to them. I want to talk to two people who write the checks. I want to talk to the auditor. Those are the top ones. I'm working my way down. And that's deciding what I want to do. And that's just, you're taking inventory of what you're doing. And you got to take that as fast and prudently as you can. Because there's going to be people in there that says, well, I'm out of here. I don't like this. And they have to be replaced. So, well, who have y'all had on your list? I want to talk to them. You see what I mean? They just don't come on branches, you know. I'm going to call you. So, are you ready to take this position? You see what I mean?
Can I say something about pesticides and GMOs? My impression of, and correct me if I'm wrong, the spraying you do for GMO crops is much more lethal and cancerous than the spraying that people used to do as far as what we... pesticides. I mean, the pesticides were dangerous, but the GMOs.
GMO is a genetic modified plant, so you can use spray.
So you can use a whole lot of stuff that you never used before.
Well, Roundup will kill you dead on the door, and kill anything.
Right.
You can buy it down here at Walmart.
Right.
I know that.
Right. I know. I know that. But the point is that, as an agriculture commissioner, you are not saying we're going to eliminate all pesticides. You're saying we're going to try to eliminate the spraying that is particularly required for GMO.
And first off, you're not going to eliminate anything without that to Congress.
Aren't you going, well, that is what
you can turn them in and fine them and all this stuff.
That is what you got the job for.
Yeah.
But aren't you particularly concerned about the GMO?
Are you asking me?
Yes.
Some things yes, some things no. GMOs, there's a lot of different GMOs, and I'm not here as an expert, but there are GMOs that are designed to allow you to spray more pesticide.
That's it.
But there are GMOs for a lot of other things. There are GMOs specifically designed to increase the rate at the things will ripen and mature. There are GMOs that increase the various contents that change the chemical content of a plant so that it has more protein or less of this or less of that. I'm not going to answer any more questions. I'm not here. My main problem, though, if
carbon
I had a problem.
Carbon dioxide, you're talking about GMOs. Carbon, when they bring in from Florida or something, they pick them green and put carbon dioxide to make them ripen.
The problem I have with GMOs currently is that Monsanto dominates, and it's mm-hmm. their extremely aggressive enforcement of their right to own living organisms.
I agree with that.
And it only takes, if they take a DNA strain and very slightly modify it, they are currently claiming that they have legal ownership of that entire DNA strain. And if a piece of pollen flies 500 miles and lands on your crop, and you cross-pollinate your entire crop, and their inspector happens to walk in and catch it 2 years later, then you have just wiped out your crops. It doesn't belong to you.
Yeah.
And that,
that's wrong. That is
I firmly expect my agriculture commissioner to be standing up on the horse and shouting that I'm not farming.
I got a whole media. I got a whole media down there, and I got two people responsible for media.
You should be more than that?
No, I think there's seven people.
Yeah, okay. Well,
and then there's two or three that's ahead of it. I met some of them. No, they were young kids. 26 or 7 beats in this hard going back through.
Now see, you got a budget now. When you get down there, you can decide how many people you got working in each of these areas.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not applying for a job, I'm just telling you.
Yeah, I understand where that is. That's 598. You tell where it goes. You get with your auditor and your people who write the checks, find out what's coming every month for employees and gas and electric and rent.
And you go back to the legislature and say, look, I haven't had a cost of living raise in 5 years. I need $725 million. You want Texas. Texas has got the largest agricultural acreage in the nation, and we're fifth in the nation in agricultural produce.
$100 billion income every year.
Fifth in the nation, and we're the largest. California dwarfs us. Mm-hmm. Perry doesn't mention that when he's down talking about how much better we are.
You're that's back to politics.
Point. That's good.
Politics is not my game.
I know, I just thought I'd throw it in.
Yeah, politics is...
But to do a job in Texas...
You got to stand up to politics.
To do a job in Texas effectively, you have to look at the figures, too. And
that's
we do have more land.
Well, that's not a fair comparison. I threw that out. That's a red
agricultural,
area.
Agricultural, you know,
I get your
land.
Point. You just want to make
10 acres of land somebody bought. It's not being used. It's out of use. We're spreading out instead of up.
And, we went this past weekend to Waxahachie.
Right.
I grew up in cotton country, and they talk about when cotton was king.
Right.
Cotton is gone. All I saw was some corn and a few forms of sunflowers.
Well,
and that's it.
They still raise cotton in West Texas mostly. I got two farm farmers.
This is a West Texas cotton farmer's daughter.
Yeah, but they put it in big bales
the
now.
The usage of that land, mm-hmm. Some of that does come through your office, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah.
And although they have some freedoms of what they can plant.
Right. I mean, you got an office in Lubbock, Texas, sitting right there.
Yeah, the ground and how much rainfall, if they can irrigate and all these things.
Well, they got laws on how much they can irrigate. They got meters on the well, and that's in Uvalde, too. They're selling the water rights for $5,000. San Antonio can use them. That's why I'm saying desalination is the wave of the future. It's not conservation, it's getting more water.
A couple of other things I was asked to ask you, and I don't know that there's anything you can do about them.
Mm-hmm.
You and I both grew up on a farm. You're still on a farm. Neither one of us are kids.
No.
But unfortunately, we're not much over the average age. I'll be 70 on my next birthday. You're in your 60s, I think.
63. 63. 64 when I take office.
So at 64 means you're about 5 years older than the average farmer in the state of Texas. So I think it's 58 or 59.
Well, that was a couple
now.
Years ago. It's actually getting a little older.
So you're
each year. I'm right in there, yeah.
Yeah.
Most farmers I know by age.
So, Jim, I'm planning to live forever, but I'm not sure if you are or not. So what's going to happen when we're gone?
Well, there's a torch out there, or handle here, that I'm going to give that young guy. It's his baby. Win, lose, or draw. Now it's yours. The best way to do it is prepare for it. In old days, you know, you had a young girl or a young man to ride tractors, and they either liked it or didn't. You know, I had a bunch of brothers, and we all went into business.
They didn't need $1 million to start farming.
If a $200,000 tractor was in comparison to a $3,000 John Deere, that's parity, but it's not.
No.
Parity would be about $30,000, but then you'd only need 200 or 300 acres, and they could make a living off 200 or 300 acres. You know why? Because they had a place to sell it to. If you was German, you had 10 creamers here and 10 in Dallas. It's a small German, you could get a price, you could bargain. This guy didn't pay enough, then the co-ops and stuff come in. Now you can only sell to two people. They control the market. Now, to take that away from them, it's like the Walmarts, you know what I mean? They control. It's called monopoly. You never heard that word. And that's why we pay like we do. We get all our stuff from overseas at $1 a day. We get it from Mexico.
Okay. As agriculture commissioner, what can you do, or what would you do, or what should you do to turn that around?
First off, you get out and talk to older farmer, says, do you have a son or something taking over for your land? I'm talking to you. And you said, no, I don't. So what are you going to do, your land? Are you going to divide up and you're going to sell it?
My problem, Jim, you just come to me and talk to me about it, and I'm going to tell you, well, my problem is that I used to be a turkey farmer, and Pilgrim's got this thing set up over here where they got 15 acres and 15 million turkeys, and I can't compete with them, and they're sitting there, and these turkeys live in their own crap. They don't ever move more than 5 feet. Mm-hmm. They've been genetically modified so they grow all breast and all legs.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Have you heard of organic? All this crap that's going on TV, people don't want to eat that. You have a choice. But now you don't have a choice. Where can you buy another turkey? Now you're getting organic. It's a small farmer selling those turkeys for about 10 times he does. If you got money, you can buy that turkey. But if you make it minimum wage, sorry, you got to eat the bad turkey. Now that's realism.
But how we change it?
That is a good question. I don't know that I have the answer to that. Now, most people will tell you, they'll lie to you, whatever. But like I said, when you go into there, you got a lot of people in there a lot smarter than you are. If you don't, you're in trouble. That's what I've got to around
like
to you.
More tea.
If they don't have people in there
like
smarter
tea,
in their field than I am, we're in trouble. That's why you got to have the smartest people. If I'm going to tell you I'm going to go down and I'm going to be the smartest person in that deal, again, that is not right. You think Sid Miller or anybody else is smarter than those people? No. You've got to have the smartest people.
I haven't lined up to talk to Sid Miller yet.
I don't care. Talk to Sid. I mean, that's what a democracy is. I've always told him, don't just Google me. Google Sid.
Oh, I Googled him. I'm just not interested in talking to him.
I've met Sid. I don't have no problem. He's a good cowboy. If you want to drink some beer with him, I mean, I wouldn't really want to have you spend my money the way, you know. Like, that's not slinging mud. I hate to talk about somebody else because I need to talk about myself. He can take care of himself.
I didn't ask you to talk about the other job applicants. Okay. Sid's got his own application.
Got his own deal. That's
somebody
exactly.
else's. Somebody else's review
kind of
his application.
I convince you. That's it.
Thank you.
So
I'll give this to my cashier.
But basically, when you get in there, there's no other deal than take an inventory of what people are doing, what's been going on, and making your plan and go forward.
Okay, it's as simple as you can say. Well, I haven't kept you a long time, but tell me, you know, in as few words or as however you'd want to put it. Once I elect Jim Hogan, first off, I'm a voter in the state of Texas. Why I should have Jim Hogan as my agriculture commissioner and what the priorities, not just maintenance. I mean, you told me you want to manage the thing, but as you know, goals to work towards, what are the ideals? What are the things that Jim Hogan would like to see instituted? What would you, if you go in as Texas agriculture commissioner in 4 years, what differences should I expect to see, or could I know that you have been working towards as Ag Commissioner in the state of Texas?
When you go to sleep at night, you can rest assured I'm going to kind of have the best people in that office to give the services that they give. And the problems will come to you over the phone, through the mail, in magazines. They'll be on your front door every day. Make sure that you've got people in there that can handle them, work towards them, and you can't solve all the problems, but you can solve some of them, and you work towards all of them. And that's about as simple as you're going to be. You can't promise what, you don't know what 4 years, we might be in a war. You can't answer 4 years, you got to answer today.
Now, what I'm asking though is what, are there any changes? Are you saying?
Surely they're going to be changed. Anybody going in there is going to be changed.
What would your goals be? Not what would pop up. But in an ideal world, if you could go in and change the agriculture state of Texas, what would you be working toward? What are the efforts? You've only got, every person on this world's only got so much time, so much energy.
Mm-hmm.
When Jim Hogan walks into the office on a Monday morning and sits down, except for putting out all the fires, mm-hmm. we've both been in business. We know there's going to be fires popping up. But behind those fires, when you started out in your dairy farm, you had an end in mind. It wasn't just, I'm going to get up in the morning and do the task. You had a goal in mind that you worked towards. You're asking me to put you in office. 4 years, you're going to have a 4-year shot at it. What are the goals? What are the changes you would like to see?
Well, in dairy business, no, they waited 4 years. You made sure your cows conceived a calf, had clean milk, the hay was out, you had abundant supply of that. It was a step by step.
That's daily.
You didn't plan 4 years ahead. You might have had a vision, but
it's a vision.
Vision would be, we had a lot of new young farmers taking over for all of us. The land would be affordable for young people. We had no GMOs, but had organic crops that people would like. But this is a pipe dream. You know, this is not realistic. That's what I would envision, but it ain't gonna happen. That's why I hate to put that out there. It's just not going to happen.
Isn't it realistic if that is your goal, you're more likely to get some of it done, and so isn't it
realistic?
Well, you're
going to work toward it. Like I said, yeah. when you did every day's work, you get closer and closer. In other words, today is you have. Tomorrow is just a dream. And the past is something to study for.
Right,
so you don't repeat it.
But you were pretty well on your way to answering his question as to what your goals were until you said, but I'm not going to do them because it takes
it's not, I don't think it's, you can get there realistically.
You can say, we won't have your ideal, but this is what I'm working for.
Yeah, we that's want younger farmers, and that's what I said.
Don't you want him to stop it? This is what we're working
that's
for.
That's political.
I want him to say what he said. I don't want him to say what I want him to say.
Yeah, he wants to know what, my deal. But I'm just saying.
You're not, I haven't filed for any office, and you wouldn't want to vote for me anyway. I'm too old and lazy, set in my ways.
But you got to be realistic.
You got to go for a young man like that.
You say, okay, I'm going to start with 100 cows, and I'm going to have 1,000. Without loans. That could be your goal. But you got to realize you may have to compensate somewhere along the line because it's not coming about.
True. But if you never plan to have 1,000 cows to start with.
Yeah. Well, my goal would be, like I said, in a perfect world, we wouldn't have pesticides.
And if I'd already decided that 600 acres is all that I could handle, then I certainly wouldn't be buying 1,000 either.
But, my main goals are to get young farmers. We've got to happen. And they're going to happen somewhere. Either corporations going to do it or young farmers. The stores are going to be behind it, H-E-B, Kroger. They may be wanting to get a check. You got so many of these people, this brick wall.
Actually,
but you got.
I apologize. You just brought something up that's on your list of duties, and I hadn't even mentioned it, and I forgot about it now. And that's rural development. That's part of your job, is increasing tourism, increasing. And rural means small towns.
Well, most of them give septic tanks. Kirchhoff told me the other day in Silver Spring they opened up a new septic system for them. And that's what most of them are.
It's a lot of things. You're supposed to be handling
new business. Right, I understand that.
And tourism.
Okay. What do you want me to do? Put up a.
I don't care. Okay. I just want to know what you want to do.
Okay.
Don't, it make,
well, it does make a difference what people want.
I know.
When you go to a town.
But I'm here asking. Yeah. I'm not a representative of the entire state of Texas. I'm just a questioner.
Okay, it's a big state.
It is a big state.
Who gets these areas? You don't have enough money for every town. Does Houston get it or Dallas?
How do you decide? Houston, Dallas, last time I looked, were not really rural enclaves. But.
Well, they get a lot of stuff from the Ag Department.
Mm-hmm.
You see, well, this is Ag Department, and it does represent city people because they eat food. It has.
And they sure pump a lot of gasoline.
Yeah. You see what I mean? So, yeah, these are tough questions. They're hypothetical questions because...
Well, they're not hypothetical questions if you take office. They're questions, very specific questions about what the man's going to be in charge of that office is going to be doing.
I understand that where you come from, but you got to talk to those people in office and see what's been happening. What's their... what am I going to say? They're already old people. They've already got it committed. They're on the hook for so much stuff. See what I mean? They may be a year or two on the hook. Have already approved stuff. See, when I can tell you a story, but it might not be the honest truth, and that's why I hate to tell you that. And then when I tell you I'm going to do this, no, I'm going to work on it day by day by day. And that's honest. I mean, you got, if you're going to make a pretty yard, you just all at once wave a wand, or you plant a tree today, but that's now I want a flower bed here. You shape it. If you're a painter, that's the way you do. I mean, that's honesty.
It is. I guess what I'm asking is if I hire you to redevelop my yard, I want to know whether I'm going to come up with a Japanese pagoda with soy, with koi
you
fish
want
in
a picture
it,
of it,
or if I'm going to have an outhouse in the back with a pretty moon. I want to know what you're working towards. You may not get there, but I want to know what.
But that's your backyard. This whole state.
It's my backyard, too. I've been here a long, long time.
I understand, but you might not. She may have been in Lubbock. You may be in Waxahachie. Y'all got two different ideas. It's
but
a little bit more complicated.
But I only got one ag commissioner. And
I understand.
And I need to know kind of where you are.
Well, I don't know the lady in Lubbock that I'm going to be dealing with or the one in Waxahachie.
Well,
that's why you have to have a little trust in
her. How are you going to weigh that?
The money we got? How bad it is? We may have to have a selective, God has so to speak. I don't know at this point. You got a lot of stuff you're going to before you make those decisions. You don't make them here at the table when you don't even know. You just don't do that. I don't think that's avoiding your question. It's just a good answer.
No, I don't think it is either. I think you've tried your best to answer them, and I've taken up a lot of your time. I appreciate it.
Well, I appreciate it.
And I've enjoyed
it. And like I said, all I can say is I work hard, and I'll meet with people and make sure we got smart people in.
When you get elected, I'm going to come down and say, Jim, now you got elected because of me, so I need some help on getting the bugs out of my backyard garden.
Okay, well, I said...
You can send your daughter...
We're probably going to hire Neil Sperry.
No, I don't want Sperry.
We might hire Neil Sperry since he's organic.
No, Neil's not.
I said
May. Neil's not. It's the other guy that no, Neil's yeah. Neil's the pesticide guy from Texas A&M. It's the other one.
No, Dallas, that's the organic guy.
No, it's
the dirt doctor, one dude does it naturally.
That's not Neil, that's the other guy.
Garrett?
Yeah, that's him. Yeah. Garrett.
I couldn't think of his name. It's Garrett.
Okay, yeah.
You will hire Garrett. Neil is.
I knew there's one of them over. Yeah. I don't listen to him, but I know there's one
well,
over.
I've got Neil's books. He's
a dirt doctor.
Yeah, Garrett.
Everything's natural.
Yeah.
He doesn't use the word organic.
No.
Anyway.
No.
No, that's just the way I say it.
Well, I've enjoyed it.
Overused.
It is overused.
Misused.
Yes, that's it why really I hate to use this political slang. And
is that machine? Turn that machine off.
No.